Tourniquet is most commonly used in limbs surgery, in both for general surgery as well as routine orthopedic practice. Now, I think for our resident, the knowledge regarding the tourniquet must be clear and must be updated. And within next 10 minutes, I want to clarify the OT discipline and the modern operative techniques. Regarding the OT theater discipline, I just want to show this picture. Why? Because this is the ancient operation theaters. During that period, they don't use masks, even gloves. At that time, patient was lie down within a theater, and the operation will be demonstrated over the theater, and all the resident doctor used to see this above this theater. So operation is called operation theater, but recent orthopedics or recent operation theater is revolutionized due to day by day discovery. Now, regarding the history of tourniquet, Jean-Louis Petit first coined the word tourniquet. At that time, he used to use this tourniquet for lower limb amputation and reduce the blood loss. Even due to for trauma, they can use that. And after that, Johann Friedrich von Esmarch has introduced Esmarch tourniquet in our practice. This Esmarch tourniquet still now useful for our day-to-day orthopedic practice. It's nothing but a elastic rubber bandage. And in 1904, Harvey Cushing has discovered the pneumatic tourniquet. This pneumatic tourniquet has control by a monitor where this pressure can be monitored digitally. Now, regarding some exsanguination, what do we mean by exsanguination? Exsanguination is a procedure where we can peel off all the venous blood from this limb, and by this Esmarch tourniquet. After that, the tourniquet already covered this limb that will going to act. So this is called exsanguination. Now, in some case, you should not do vigorous exsanguination because we have to see some venules or arterioles to know the proper anatomical position and to prevent post-operative hematoma, and to for ease of identification of small arteriole, like in case of radius plating, we have to dissect the radial artery and vena communis along with some branches. So if we do this exsanguination very vigorously, we cannot see this during the operation, and after the tourniquet removal, that will bleed vigorously and we cannot control that bleeding. We may have to ligate the artery also. So specially for this vascular area, exsanguination must not done vigorously. Now, some contraindication of this exsanguination: one is infection, second is malignant bone tumor, third is suspected case of DVT and huge swelling. When we have to encounter this type of cases, we should not do exsanguination. For this case, what we have to do? We have to go for 5-minute elevation exsanguination. Means by DVT, I will put this leg for 5 minutes, then we will on this tourniquet. That is very helpful. This is called an elevation exsanguination. Now, regarding the pneumatic tourniquet, this pneumatic tourniquet is monitored by a machine, and there is a special gas hoses, and that is a automated machine and you can control the BP or you can control the pressure digitally. You can control the time and duration of this tourniquet digitally, and also it will give some alarm after a expected time schedule. But current technology used for a specialized tourniquet is called limb occlusion pressure tourniquet. We have to know about limb occlusion pressure. It is a minimum tourniquet pressure that will require to occlude the blood flow to the specific patient's limb at the specific time and account for the patient limb and vessel characterized and the type and fit up of the cuff of the tourniquet. Now limb occlusion pressure can be determined by gradually increasing the tourniquet pressure until distal arterial pulses ceases, and as indicated by a device sensing the blood flow such a Doppler stethoscope. Or studies have shown that cuff pressure based on limb occlusion pressure measured immediately prior to the surgery is generally lower than commonly used cuff tourniquet pressure and is sufficient to maintain a satisfactory surgical field or bloodless field. So in this discussion we can easily understand what is limb occlusion pressure. Now recently used proper tourniquet has been changed its armamentarium day by day. First of all, we still use this as much for exsanguination, but there is some modification of the of this pneumatic tourniquet. If for limb, for lower limb like thigh, there is a conical shape. So for this, if we put a circular tourniquet, then the proximal portion of the thigh will get huge pressure, but distal portion of the thigh will not get proper pressure. So one modification is conical tourniquet cuff for the thigh. Now another modification is limb occlusion pressure based higher mitre center. This also called automated tourniquet system. It are capable to provide safety feature that are not possible in older mechanical tourniquet. This system can monitor the cuff infiltration time as well as regulate the cuff pressure to a known pressure throughout the surgical procedure. Some microprocessor control the tourniquet are capable of calculating the proper pressure to ensure the complete blood occlusion in about 30 seconds, and this assist the operating room staff is deciding what is the tourniquet pressure should be set at on a pre-present basis. Means before anesthesia we have to check the BP. This is called induction BP. As per induction BP informed by anesthesia, we will put this in the cup along with this special processor is called microprocessor, which is already inbuilt in the specialized monitor system, which will automatically check the limb occlusion pressure and it will act accordingly. Okay, now what should be the ideal tourniquet pressure is actually 50 to 100 millimeter of mercury above the systolic blood pressure. For upper limb it is 250, for lower limb 350, but it is actually manually written. But for I again pressurize on this limb occlusion pressure based tourniquet, automated tourniquet, because suppose we are dealing with a child, we are dealing with a female, we are dealing with a muscular human man. Now for all this patient limb occlusion pressure will vary, so that tourniquet pressure must be vary, otherwise it can cause damage. So if we can get this automated tourniquet, that is best. If we cannot get, we can at least use this pneumatic tourniquet, that will help, and you have to follow this rule. And for tourniquet time, Initial time is 90 minutes, but ideally is 45 to 60 minutes. After that, there will be a chance of soft tissue edema and the post-tunicate syndrome. I will discuss it shortly. More than 2 hours, if we need for tunicate time, then we have to give some respiratory time or respiratory interval. What does it mean? We will put a soaked gauze over the surgical field and we wrap this wound with a compression bandage and we'll release the tunicate and ask the anesthesia for controlling the patient vitals. Now we will wait for 5 to 10 minutes. After that, again we have to put for elevation exsanguinis and put the tunicate on. Now, what should the length of this tunicate? Ideally, standard is 8.5 centimeter and 15 centimeter conical separate tunicate is better. And you have to know tunicate size, the breadth of the tunicate will the increased size or increased breadth of the tunicate decrease the chance of tunicate complication. And regarding the timing, it should be as per OT protocol and as per need of the surgeon. Now, one to two things I want to tell. Use of a tunicate is very helpful for doing the operation, but this is a boomerang because it can cause many problems like nerve injury, like muscle injury, vascular damage, skin injury, hematoma, bleeding. Skin injury means blister and ecchymosis maybe. And sometimes tunicate failure, venous tunicate means suppose you have given tunicate, but when you are putting your knife, it will bleed vigorously. That means this pressure is not the adequate, or there is some mechanical failure of the machine that can cause only venous obstruction, no arterial obstruction. So that tunicate must be removed in the operation during the operative period. So I will and suppose you have put a tunicate and you just forgot about that. Suppose it is a SMAS tunicate, then such complication can take the life of the patient, not only endanger the limb of the patient. Why? Because after if we put this tunicate more than 4 hours, then there if then we remove this, then there is chance of 95 to 90% chance of sudden cardiac arrest or respiratory failure, and patient will suddenly collapse. So in that case, we not only jeopardize the limb's availability, we also endanger the life of the patient. So be careful about use of the tunicate. How we can take the prevention? The tunicate must be used only for recommended time and check the accuracy of the pressure before tunicate application. An effective pressure to be achieved by limb occlusion pressure, that will be most effective. But sometimes we can do normal pneumatic tunicate or SMAS tunicate judiciously, and tunicate must be applied by the senior most surgeon of that team, because that in the pressure over this field is very important to prevent the consequences. And before application of this tunicate, you have to put some very good cotton and good wrapping over this soft wrapping over this limb. Otherwise, it can cause multiple problems like blister, like if we put like betadine soakage and betadine burn, and we have to check that tunicate before the application. Now, what are the possible complications? Most common complication is post-tourniquet syndrome. This is a combined effect of the muscle ischemia, edema, and microvascular congestion or reperfusion injury. The affected limb will be stiff, pale, weak, but not paralyzed, and subjectively there will be numbness without any objective anesthesia, and prolonged bleeding time from the surgical wound, and it will typically resolve within 1 to 6 weeks. Now, there is a chance of compartment syndrome also. It is a relative complication of tourniquet, and in that case, that may be due to long OT time, or there were not preoperative lip checkup of that limb also. And if there is any blister appears over the tourniquet side, you have to just give a dressing after the OT. After that, you can put any antibiotic ointment, and that will heal automatically within 2 to 3 days. But there is a chance of blister if we not follow the proper soft padding of the limb. And contraindication for tourniquet is peripheral vascular disease, severe trauma to the limb, head injury, severe infection of the limb, DVT, severe arthritis changes, bone spur, previously fracture, and there is some active infection, and poor skin condition, arteriovenous fistula, lack of inappropriate equipment, and sickle cell hemoglobinopathy is also a contraindication for tourniquet. Now, I will suggest some advice for our resident. Use etiosterile tourniquet as much as possible, or at least autoclave tourniquet, such with a proper padding manner. Now, judiciously use tourniquet only for dissection and instrumentation time. After that, you can remove the tourniquet and make all setup ready before putting tourniquet, along with all planning and instrument checkup. Otherwise, you can extend the tourniquet time without any good thing. Remove tourniquet before going to close the wound for proper hemostasis. It can cause postoperative hematoma, and chance of compartment syndrome is very high. And inform anesthesia before removing the tourniquet, because if patient going into cardiac shock, or in going to any type of metabolic problem, any type of anesthesia problem, you cannot manage with a junior anesthesia team. You have to inform their team, must. And do not massage over the area where tourniquet is applied. This is our most common mistake done by our resident. It can cause dislodge of the thrombus, even it can cause thrombembolism, and increase chance of cardiac arrest, because it will suddenly release all the metabolites from the limb to the circulation. And always try to follow our surgical safety protocol or checklist. I will discuss it one by one. Before entering to your operation theater, counseling is very important. Why I put this slide in a one big slide? Because it is the most common, most vital, and most important step for any operative intervention in this medical legal case problem era. Why? Like in our plane, before takeoff, they used to tell that we are going to die. We may going to die. So how we can prevent, or what we have to do at that time? They will explain everything. After that, they will tell happy journey or enjoy your flight. But like that, you have to explain everything to patient along with the family member, and describe all the possible problem that we can going to face, and we assure them that we are ready to give our 100% effort to encounter everything. Now, I just want to point out some special point regarding the operation theater we have to maintain. Before going to OT, we have to know the zonal area of the OT. Proper modern OT must be placed on the first floor of any institute, because it will automatically decrease the chance of infection. And there will be a zone where the surgeon will enter in the OT from the back door, not in the front door, which we used to see the surgeon will enter and patient will enter, and patient family member will enter, GDS staff will enter, sister will enter, same enters. No, that is not the ideal protocol. Ideal protocol will be OT, surgeon and health worker will enter to the OT, or instrument company will enter in the OT from the opposite direction of the OT theater. And OT theater main gate will be open only for the patient in and out, family member. Their family member will wait outside of the OT. Now, there will be a red marking zone, as well as doctor where going to enter from the OT from the back door, there will be a red marking zone. They should not cross the red marking zone with a outer shoe or outer dress. After that, there will be a changing room. You have to change accordingly, and you will put your mask and gloves properly. Then you come to the OT zone 2. That OT zone 2 is constituted of surgeon lounge, and then you come to the operation theater or the main theater. And this is our modular OT, where is laminar airflow OT, and is mandatory for recent guideline of the orthopedic surgery. And see the wall, there is no dead end of the wall. This has been blunted. Why? Because of laminar airflow outlet, as well as it will decrease the dead space of the OT. It will help to prevent infection also. Now, all the monitor are skin touch. Okay. Now, before OT, we used to do shaving of the limb. We should not do shaving by blade, sharp object. Do not use any French like any epilion. It can cause a commensal infection over that area and inoculation of bacteria by the sharp cut or abrasion. We must use for a planned surgery is trimmer. It is the recent recommendation. Even for every patient, we can change a new blade. And hand wash is the most preventive and most effective method to prevent surgical site infection. Practice has been done accordingly. And during the hand wash, we should not touch anything. Like we used to take soap, then we use it and we will put this on a bucket. No, this is not the protocol. Actually, all should be skin touch. There is a small outlet for the betadine scarf, and by paddle of the leg paddle that will come on your hand. Even we should not waste water, and that water also skin touch. But in our setup, we have to work with this soap, but try to misuse this contamination, and we have to put this in the soap after washing and it with a running water. It will help to prevent infection also. And after entering the OT, we have to use this towel, one towel for one hand, and we will swap this hand from distal to proximal, not proximal to distal. That too, is the most common mistake done by each and every resident. And two towel minimum use, and the distance from the sterile environment minimum 1 second distance. Okay, now gloves wearing is very important. You should not touch the inner side of the gloves. It is contaminated, and you have to know the all the steps and left hand first use, then your right hand, and you have to make it very perfect, or it is a practice how to use the gloves. You must go to the YouTube videos. Now entering OT, do not put your hand down of your shoulder of your umbilical line, and do not put your hand above the shoulder line. This is a OT theater discipline. And do not open your nose, please. And during that scrubbing, there will be must holded by a OT staff. And if there is any chance of pathological fracture, or if any chance of any weakened bone that can cause fracture, in that case the surgeon must hold this this limb throughout the procedure. Otherwise it can complicate the operation. And during the dressing taping, you have to maintain a proper distance from this unsterile side to sterile side, and it is called shielding or covering the whole area, and this area called zone 1. This is only for all the surgical teams. And in the OT, we just please note that we used to use betadine scrub. Nowadays the betadine has decreased its use because it can cause skin blister. If once blister is arise, it is hard, very hard to manage, and skin some patient may develop permanent permanent black staining of the wound. So avoid betadine. We used to use chlorhexidine or alcohol based solution even for scrub also. And dressing taping must be done in a proper manner. And regarding the blood requisition, in our hospital we used to waste many blood, and we don't know the actual the protocol. And in a proper central institute like Tata Memorial Mumbai or any big big institute, they use this blood very judiciously. This is called vacuum shooter. You will draw the blood, and you will make the requisition. You will send the sample through this vacuum shooter with a patient specific code, and that shooting system will enter to the blood bank, and blood bank person will already have this blood, and they will check and cross match, and the required blood will transfer direct to the OT. And this is the desk that in the OT field, and they can use it immediately. So there will be no wastage of blood, there will be no time delay of the blood taking time in case of any type of big limb salvage surgery or any big surgery. This is called vacuum shooter. And before going to operations starting, we have to do the proper dressing and dipping. After the dressing dipping, during the intubation or during the induction, and there is we must use antibiotic in our general orthopedic practice. And the OT sister will assure you regarding the OT sterility. Recently, Bacillus sterothermophilus for the autoclave or Bacillus subtilis for ETO strip must be kept in this OT drum and or instrument drum that will show you that the instrument has been properly sterilized. Now there is a surgical checklist. As each and every patient must follow this surgical checklist, that will help to prevent any type of complication. Before anesthesia, patient identification, procedure, consent, site mark or not, the anesthesia, any accelerated issue is not, any allergy is present or not, any error problem, or it needs any blood, extra blood, that will be all be checked. Before giving incision, this is called surgical timeout. One sister will utter for confirmation. All the team member have introduced themselves by name and the role. Surgeon, anesthesia, professional nurse verbally confirm patient name, site and the procedure. Anticipate the critical event from the surgeon, from the anesthesia and from the nursing point of view. And antibiotic prophylaxis is given or not, or is any essential imaging is needed, is displayed or not. Along with, we have to check all the instrument by our OT personnel. After the operation, when patient will go out from the OT, you have to confirm again regarding the official documentation, regarding any instrumentation misput, or the specimen has been labeled or not, and the if there is any equipment issue or not, and must check the IV line and the catheter. I added this point to our resident, and that protocol must be tagged in the patient BST for a documentation purpose. And for teaching purpose, we can have all the resident together for demonstrating any operation. But for any professional field or any routine surgery, we should not overgather our OT. Overgathering can cause infection. There and each and every person have their job specification. One will be trolley in charge, one will be instrument in charge, one will be S2, one will hold the limb. So each and everything is specified. And recent recent update of the marks is space suit marks. We recently use to prevent infection. And regarding the antibiotic, for clean cut surgical wound in a elective surgery, only 2 IV dose is recommended. If OT time is cross 3 hours or huge blood loss more than 1 liter, then we can repeat IV antibiotic. Even no oral is needed. But in our setup, we cannot maintain our OT protocol, so we have to use the antibiotic up to 3 days, IV antibiotic. But as per AA, American Association of Orthopedic Association guideline, if you can control all the procedure which I have told you, and all the system are very well equipped, then only 2 doses is antibiotic for any of big operation like total hip replacement is enough. And last but not the least, operation is a teamwork. Credit will be divided to all, but discredit must be encountered by chief surgeon S1 only. So you have to be very, very, very cautious for each and every step of your operation, and I think we will do well. Best of luck.